Okay, we're back. Thank you again. I know. Wow, what a day. I can't believe you. Well, actually, I can believe that you guys are still here. And you're here in your numbers to the point where we've now put a television and some speakers outside. I realize that it's been difficult today to get in. But you know what? I'm happy to say that that's a good problem to have, that it's clearly that you guys are enjoying the day and you're really interested in what we have programmed for you. So thank you. I am going to introduce and welcome our final financing panel for the day. We do have another session directly after this. It's the IndieWire series, and today is the first of that series, so that's going to be at 5:30. So if you are here, stick around. There will be another session right afterwards. But right now, we are going... So what we've done today, we've basically gone... We've gone all the way through financing, and our last session, we went from micro-budgeting, and now we're going into big money. And I have with us Cassian, and he is going to be our moderator today. And I will turn over to Cassian, and you can introduce the panel. Thank you.
My poor brother, Kerry, Elwes, which is how it's pronounced, has had to suffer his entire life with having his last name mispronounced, which I think is, may not have helped him in his career, honestly. But for me, I'm very lucky because my first name is Cassian, so most people know that there aren't too many of those. I'm sitting here with a very esteemed group, and I'm just going to quickly kind of go. Jamin O'Brien, wonderful, wonderful producer, just produced a movie called Hateship, Loveship that we worked on together. He used to work at a company called Worldview, which is a equity financing company. So he's seen it from both sides, from the financing angle and also from the actual physical production part of making movies. Next to him, we have Kerry Barden, probably with his partner Paul Schnee, one of the greatest casting directors working right now. Everyone chases these guys to work on their movies with them. They have amazing taste. Their credits, I won't even go over them, they're just amazing. Then Yewande, who I don't really know, we just met outside, okay, Yewande, why don't you say what you've done exactly? Because I don't want to butcher this.
My name is Yewande Sadiku. I'm a Nigerian investment banker, but I have a private interest in film financing. And our first film, Half of a Yellow Sun, is having its world premiere. It's a gala, it's a special presentation at this year's TIFF. Thanks.
Okay. And then next to her, we have Jay Cohen, who runs the independent film area for the Gersh agency. One of the top agencies in California. I used to do the similar job at William Morris, so I know what a formidable competitor he was, or is. I'm not sure we actually ever really competed against each other, but we've actually tried to work together on stuff. He's the best, and I really wanted to have somebody on the panel from the agency perspective to kind of explain where their role fits into this world, because we're going to kind of do an exhaustive look at how movies get financed and how equity works. And then next to him, and he's going to hate that I said this, is a major player called Michael Benaroya, who very quietly, who very quickly in the last 3 years has become a major, major figure in independent film financing. I've been very fortunate to have worked on a couple of movies that he put the money into, but he's the man. He has a company called Benaroya Pictures. He recently formed a foreign sales entity to run alongside that called IFT. And he is here in Toronto with a number of films that he put money into. So he's a key person in this interview process in this panel process, we go forward and explain his point of view in terms of how movies get financed. And then there's me. I used to be an agent at William Morris for 15 years. I ran an independent film area, as I said. I worked on over close to 300 movies. I have a movie here called The Dallas Buyers Club that's playing tonight. That I was involved in putting the financing together. It's a movie that was around for 15 years. I worked on it for not that long. Since I left William Morris about 3 years ago, 4 years ago, 3 years, I don't know how long it's been, I've made like 25 movies. So when I say I make them, I actually go out and raise money and put financing together for films and work through the entire process. So part of this is going to be a little bit educational. Part of it will be a little bit fun, I hope. And part of it will be, you know, Q&A with all of you guys afterwards to get a feel from you guys in a way, what it is that you're trying to figure out. Just quickly, who here is a producer? If you put your hands up. Okay, everybody. All right, good. Any writer-directors? Oh, okay, all right, well, that's good, too. All right, good, let's start. So, Michael, as I said, you haven't been doing this for an enormous amount of time, but you have put together quite a few movies recently in the last 3-4 years since I've known you, actually. And I think that you, when I met you, you'd already done 3 movies. And then we got to work, I think, on your 4th, which was Margin Call, that you fully financed and became a big hit for all of us, and for you particularly. I would like to start with you in a way and kind of think about what it is as an equity financier. Why did you come into the business? Why did you want to do this? Why did you want to put your own money into it? And what is your goal?
Well, I guess why did I get into the business? I thought it would be more fun than what I was doing, which was real estate. Has been more fun than that. Also, you know, I've always kind of been a cinephile and watch everything. And so I, you know, always wondered how it was that these movies came together. And, you know, I guess it's sort of clear how studio movies come together. Somebody up there just kind of green lights it and writes a check. But independent films are often a little more complex and you're fitting different, you know, financiers together and their needs together. What makes me want to put my own money into it, I guess, was that, you know, when you find a film you believe in and you don't think it's going to get made unless you're the one who writes the check, then I guess you write the check.
Well, it's a very, very nice way of saying he's a baller. which he is. Jay, the agencies have become obsessed now with finding people like Michael and bringing them into the business and representing them and putting money into movies. How did this happen and why? And why are the agencies so focused on it?
Well, I think there's a number of reasons why. First off, it's harder in the last 5 years. It's been harder to put independent movies together. The studios make fewer and fewer movies every year. But the distribution pipeline exists, so they need more movies to go through the system to make money, which means outside capital has to come in so that the distribution business exists. All of our actors, all of our writer-directors want to make movies outside of the studio system because you can sit in development at a studio for 15 years. As you said with Dallas Buyers Club, it's been around for 15 years. So you need outside people to come in and make those movies happen, which means our talent clients or our director clients will work for much less money than they normally would, which gives you an economic model that makes sense.
Right. And as far as the Gersh agency is concerned, I know you guys have been involved in quite a few movies that you put the financing together for. When you go and you talk to a financier out there that you're interested in being in business with and talking to and having them put money into movies that you're working on, what do you say to them exactly?
Please, we beg. Well, you know, it's quite simple. I mean, Michael's doing 2 movies with me, and what we do is we try to put together a package that makes sense. So we say, here's a movie, the budget is $10 million. These are the actors that we have attached. This is the director. You know, the good news about the film business is there's an actual model, right? I know the value of a movie based upon who I put in it, who's directing it, what the director's last movies were, and what genre it is, and I can pretty much tell you at the beginning, this movie's worth 70% out of foreign market, or 60%. And then I can say to you, let's shoot this movie in Georgia, take our 25% rebate, and now our net risk investment on a $10 million movie is $2 million. Is the value of the US market with that package worth $2 million? And you can safely say, pretty good bet. That's right. What we do, that's what we say to anybody who's cutting a check of risk.
And so just to kind of clarify that for 1 second, and maybe Jamin, you can jump in here. There's so many, you take his $10 million movie. The equity investor doesn't have to write a check for $10 million, right? How does it normally work in terms of, as far as you watching what they're doing, how the financing is assembled for a $10 million movie, you know, in terms of the different levels of finance, debt, whatever? It's on your right-hand side. It's right there.
Well, I think having been, as you said, at a film finance company that had a very stringent model, that is the most important thing, is being stringent. So I think the model that Jay is talking about and what Cassian's alluding to is you have to have a, typically you have a bank or a hedge fund that is very much about paperwork and financial disclosures and assurances. And then you have sometimes a gap lender. A gap lender may be a little bit more flexible. Oftentimes that lender is doing it sometimes as equity, sometimes as a fund or a bank. And they'll do that typically more readily against tax credits, less readily against international sales if there's a senior loan against that. And then that equity that sits at the bottom. And I think Jay's summary of how you actually convince people to do it is pretty accurate. You tell them that that's a pretty good risk.
What do you mean pretty?
I mean, which is true, though. And I think you can only, there's never been a historical analysis that's been publicized as to the value, the historical value of selling your film to the U.S. market on the domestic side. We think we have a very good plan when it comes to how much the international value is. And there's, 15 companies out there that are the gold standard of, assessing that value. But I think that the domestic risk that we're talking about in this sort of U.S. model is a best guess scenario. But you fight and fight and fight. And that's when someone like myself comes in and you bring the budgets down. You make sure that you have a rock bottom without creatively compromising the film. You have everybody taking fee cuts to do a film at the right price point.
Yewande, I was just reading your bio here quickly because we just met outside, and it's kind of impressive. And you're involved in a investment banking business in Nigeria. And so, when you go out and you put the financing together for the movie that you just worked on, which is called The Yellow Sun, you're gonna have to pick up and correct me on all of this, okay?
Sorry, it's half of a Yellow Sun.
Half. You're English. I love that. Half. Half of a Yellow Sun. Are you using similar kind of models in terms of the way that you're evaluating the project and thinking about whether or not you're going to finance the movie and what the value of that pitch is going to be when it's done and who the investors would be? Or are you just saying, okay, I found a great movie and I want to fully finance the entire thing?
I mean, my experience is, I'm sure, very different from everybody else that's seated here because I'm not really a producer. Even though I'm credited as being an executive producer, my day job is investment banking. So all of yesterday, I didn't leave the office until 5:30 when I made a dash for the airport to catch a flight here. So that's what I do, investment banking, which fundamentally, essentially, means raising money for corporates, whether it's debt, long-term debt, or it's equity. And I thought the skills that I had in investment banking I could bring onto Nollywood. Now, Nollywood is a very big, very popular Nigerian film industry. It's big in terms of the number of productions that's made. It's very well known across the world. The films that are made travel, even though some people think that the quality is not quite what it should be, the films travel anyway. And I was curious about why this industry is so big in size, but so small in financial terms. And from my inquiries, it appeared that the gap was that there was no formal financing coming behind these things. So the one project that we've done, so I don't really have 5 years experience or 15 years experience. I've got 5 years experience on only one film. It's taken us 5 years to get it here. But we raised financing for that film in a way that a Nigerian film has never been funded before. And we were able to achieve a budget that's never been achieved for a Nigerian film. But the bulk of the funding was raised from Nigerian investors. And what I did was to, producers know about how to make films, but they don't necessarily understand money. And I spent 3 of those 5 years learning about how to translate producer language into investor language and putting together a document that investors could relate to. But it was also important that investors understood that it wasn't a traditional investment. So they're not comparing it to buying Microsoft shares or Apple shares, that they understand that although this is a cold commercial investment, I wanted them to look at it also from a cultural perspective, which meant looking at it a little bit differently.
Right. Kerry, I'm going to get to you in a second. I just want to kind of go back for 1 second just to kind of give an overview again as we get into the details and the nitty-gritty of all of this. The movie business, the independent film business, has developed to the point where it's almost like where the banks were trading derivatives. And the derivative was that you could take $10 million and say, okay, the first $2 million that gets returned to investors is not risky at all. The next $2 million is a little bit risky. The next $2 million is a little bit riskier. The next $2 million is riskier. And then the last $2 million is the risk part. And that's how we've managed to make independent films these days. We were able to go borrow money against pre-sale estimates, the foreign estimates. That's the least risky part. That's what everyone calls the debt. And then you go and you try to find someone else to go into the middle. That's the mezzanine financing. And then you find the equity partner, and they get a little bit more return on their money than the debt. And then you find the equity partner at the end, and he gets the most return on his money because he's sitting at the very end, and he owns the picture, basically. He's the equity financier, the owner of the movie. But on a, let's say on a $10 million movie, the equity investor was a $3 million player in that. He's the last $3 million out, so he's definitely in the riskiest position. But for that, he owns the movie, and he didn't have to put up the full $10 million to own half the picture. The other half is owned by the director and the actors and all the other people that were creatively involved in the movie. But he definitely gets his money out before any of the creative participants are involved, and he gets a return on his money. Mike. Kerry, I'm going to come to you in 1 second. I want you to feel like I've ignored you, but I just want to kind of lay this out very quickly just so that people understand exactly where we're coming from. Mike, what traditionally are the returns on investment for debt players, mezz players, people who lend money against tax credits, and people who put equity financing into movies?
Well, if you're doing only debt and it's fully collateralized, I'd say a bank will do it for 5 or 6% and a private individual 6 to 8. For mezzanine financing, if you're getting a gap loan from a bank, which has, you know, quite a few restrictions but is uncollateralized and is against estimates from one of the top sales companies, and by the way, the restrictions include they only do about 50% of the remaining estimates and no more than 20% of the budget, that would be 10 or 11% from a bank and probably 12.5 to 15 from a private individual. If you're lending against a tax credit, probably 12.5 to 15%, which to me is the best deal in the business because you're lending against government paying you. So that's probably more secure than even the collateralized deal with a sales contract, and you actually get a better return. The only question mark is how long it takes to get paid sometimes, which is why there are not a ton of people who do it and thus drives the price up. And then as an equity investor, you have to get 20%. You'll be very hard pressed to find anyone who will give you more than that. But if you're an equity investor like me, you always want to get more than that. So how does one do that? And generally, you hide your return in fees. So you kind of say, well, we're charging you 20%, but 20% on this $1 million, but really I'm investing $1.1 million, taking $100,000 back as my legal fee or whatever, and then you take 20% on the 1.1, so you really got 1.32, so you get 32%.
That was very quick, and that's why Mike's so good at this. And that's why Mike's done very well in the business. And guys like me and Jay would have to sit there and try to figure out exactly how that worked out for everybody.
32%.
You know, stepping back for 1 second, you know, everyone's talking about foreign sales estimates. And so what happens is, and there's a lot, every suite up here in the hotel is filled with foreign sales companies that are selling movies, international rights for pitches around the world. And they have a list, it's like 40 countries of Germany, France, Italy, Spain, South America, Australia, every single country that you can think of. And what they do is they write down a number on against each country, and they come up with a crazy number that they're going to ask for and see if some sucker will pay it. And then on the other side, they write down the number that they actually think they're really going to sell it for, and they wouldn't sell it for less than that because that's the right price for it. And everyone that lends money in every part of the segment of this, either the debt lenders or the mezzanine lender or the equity investor, looks at that end column, the one that he actually thinks he's really going to sell it for, and they add that number up at the bottom, and that's the number that we work from. So on a movie that costs $10 million, you want to see foreign sales that are going to look like $6 to $8 million of estimates. Not that they're actually going to sell it, but you want to see that. And then you want to see a tax credit if you can. Could add up to $2 million. So on paper, if you sell the foreign and you've got the tax credit, you're ahead of the game. That's how we're selling investors to be part of the process and saying that the U.S. is the upside for the picture, that when we go sell the U.S., that's going to be the profit center for this movie. And then on that foreign sales estimate, they don't sell all of it up front. They sell part of it. And they go to the countries that will actually buy, and some countries will pre-buy stuff and some won't. And they start to sell it, and they take that number, what they've actually done, and they can borrow debt against that number. And Mike's talking about debt. That's what you can actually borrow from a bank against the contracts that you actually have. The mezzanine is the difference between the contracts that they have and the eventual foreign sale that they're going to get to. That's the gap. That's the money that you know is going to come in later, or you hope is going to come in later, and you can borrow money against that part. You can borrow money against the tax credit, and then the equity financer is the piece that you need to complete the financing. So I don't know if you followed all of that. But in order to pre-sell a movie, you have to have actors in it. And so the business has become almost like a meat market.
Internationally famous actors, right?
Internationally famous actors, people that you've heard of. Movie stars. Movie stars that are in other movies that were successful, or at least they're known. They're in the magazines. People know who they are. The people like myself drive poor Kerry Barden absolutely insane, because what do we do to you?
What do we do to you?
Cassian's pretty good about it, so. But it starts with a script, which I'll get from a producer like Jamin or Cassian, and then I read the script and I have to figure out whether I'll be able to beg someone in Jay's company to do the film that's worth something to Michael. If I feel like I can do that, then I'll take on a script and take on the job of casting, and then I'll make list and go back to the producers. They have their foreign sales list that are rated with the actors, which is sometimes it's fluctuating all the time because of somebody's level of, like Jennifer Lawrence did Winter's Bone, she wasn't on anyone's list, and then after Winter's Bone, of course, she's on everybody's list. So it does start with a script, and it starts with, figuring out whether anybody's going to be attracted to the script or not. And after that, then it's trying to figure out whether, how many producers' points are available for the creative team so that, since they're not working for any money, they basically invest their time in the hopes of a successful film. So there's a lot of elements to the part of casting the actors that mean something for a film that will draw the other actors as well. It's a very
and
long
how do you,
and
how do
arduous
you,
process.
I mean, I can throw this out to all of you. How do you decide what an actor's worth?
To the investors, there seems to be a list from the foreign sales companies that are meaningful in their territories. So I'll get a list and it's, X actor is worth this in Germany, but not worth, anything in Spain. So, I mean, it's also a list that comes together and it's in combination with this actor is worth, A, so you don't need anybody else. But if you get two actors that are worth B, then, you can get
this. I mean, the crazy part for me is I find myself sitting and looking at these lists all day long and saying to the directors, who are looking at it too, and saying, oh, creatively, that person's right for the movie. And then I find myself saying, oh, they're not worth anything. Mike, do you do that quite often?
Yes, all the time. I mean, there's countless times. In fact, I'm dealing with that right now.
And how do you balance your relationship with the director and creatively in terms of choosing the actors and juggling that part of it with the money aspect of it?
I think it's better not to have too much of a relationship until after you cast the movie, because if you're too good of friends while you're casting the movie, you're going to feel bad and want to cast who they want you to cast, and then you're gonna lose all your money and not get to do this anymore. So I try to kind of keep the directors generally a little bit at arm's length until after we've cast the movie, and then I'll go make friends with them. Because
until the next movie.
Well, yeah, but then you know you have to stage like a fight or something. No, I'm kidding.
Right,
but
okay.
You know, so hopefully once you've worked with someone before, you know, they respect that you have a process that's important, and right. You know, ultimately directors want their movie to make money too, because that's how they get their next movie made.
Right.
So I think if they appreciate your process and still find that you're, you know, aware of and respectful of their creative needs, and you're not just forcing, you know, any big movie star down their throat, who will do it, then, you know, they'll appreciate the process and next time be a little more savvy to it and a little, you know, more.
I mean, you're sitting, Kerry, right in the middle of this thing, and it's a fault line between the way movies get financed and the way movies actually, good movies turn out. And, you know, sometimes, I mean, I'm sure you've seen it, where movies were cast with certain people that should never have been in that movie except for the fact that they meant something.
There have been times where we've cast films that are contingent on, you know, someone's fame and financial value that is not usually not necessarily the right actor for the film. The nice thing when you get a script is you read a script and then you think, okay, this is great for so and so and so and so, and then you know, start the dialogue with the director and the producers, and it changes. With, you know, I was lucky with Winter's Bone because they had their financing, and so we just cast the movie. And they didn't need anybody famous, although, you know, there were discussions of, you know, some of the girls that were a little more famous than Jennifer at the time. And, you know, it was fortunate for everyone that it worked out that the film was cast with, you know, actors that were right for every role in the film. And that is a rare experience.
Yewande, I know that you were going to jump in here for 1 second, but hold on 1 second, because I want you to hold that thought. Uh-huh. Jamin, you also sit in a fault line, which is slightly different, which is that you're actually making the movie, and you're talking to usually the producer, who may actually also be the financier of the movie, and you're trying to juggle the cast, what the expectations are in terms of the foreign sales estimates versus what the actual budget of the movie is, and then the director, and you're in the middle of all those conversations. How do you manage the director in that process? I mean, in terms of the budget and them, and and you know, don't producers, finances come to you at some point and say, hey man, we gotta make this movie for less money. What do you do? What do you say?
Besides cut my own fee? Yeah.
When do you say that?
So that's why you wanted to be in business with him.
But well, I think what's key, and you know, we haven't talked about this, but Michael also is a very good reader. He knows how to read a script, so I think that's you know, a value that we haven't been putting up here a lot. And I think when Matthew McConaughey takes his shirt off in a romantic comedy, he gets paid differently than when he does Dallas Buyers Club or Killer Joe. And Killer Joe and Dallas Buyers Club come together when Matthew McConaughey takes a pay cut. And that's really what it comes down to. That fee, that lead actor, and we're talking a special case because Matthew is an international superstar, but even on smaller films, and I'm going through that right now with a lesser known actor, that actor is making less than Matthew's pay cut, making scale. So you can find actors that have some value but aren't major international movie stars that do fit the director's vision, and you're going to pay them scale because they're actually being a lead, or they're coming from TV, and they're, you know, Bryan Cranston just did an indie film to move into the movie business away from the TV business. So it is a trick sometimes that you have to thread the needle to make a director
right.
happy, make a good film, because that's the most important thing, and sometimes abandon a film if you don't thread that needle.
And Jay, Yewande, you were going to add something a little bit earlier, and I didn't want to skip over that.
I wasn't going to add something. I was going to be very controversial.
Oh, yeah?
Everything that you've said about debt and mezzanine and equity is right. Everything that everybody said.
Oh, my God, I thought you were about to say that I was wrong, and
everything that you've said is right, and it's exactly what I read in books. You know, but I'm sure this is true for people from emerging markets. It is not my reality. So debt is what you put your personal assets against. It's not what you lend against the cash flows. So if you've got a nice property somewhere, that's what you put debt against, not against the cash flows prepared by
some
sales agent.
By the way, that's in the real world. And in the movie business, somehow we managed to develop a different process of lending, you know?
No. I'm talking about in the movie business in Nigeria.
That's in Nigeria, all right.
Correct.
Okay, so hold on a second. Your investors are putting their houses up against the movies?
No, our investors invested equity in the film. So there's equity, there's debt, there's mezzanine.
All right, I got you. All right, Jay. I used to sit in these staff meetings, and we would talk about movies and independent movies and things that were coming along. The ugliest conversation used to be, or was, you know, and when I was doing it, was trying to explain to directors and actors why they weren't going to get paid what they wanted to get paid. And how do you do that?
Well, here's what I would say. The good news is the last few years have taught those agents in today's world that those actors aren't going to get, as Jamin just said, you know, Matthew McConaughey wants to play a part that buyers don't want to buy from him, it's going to have to discount his price. I mean, you know, for years, Julia Roberts was the biggest star in the world, but if she did something that was a drama, people didn't go. So if Julia Roberts wants to do a period movie where she's coaching a soccer team in Nigeria, no one's going to pay her. And so you have this conversation with the agent that says, look, your client has no value in this world. And it comes to Kerry Barden, which is, there's a fluidity to casting, which is, you know, as they say, old people don't buy green bananas. Foreign buyers buy yesterday, not tomorrow. So if they're buying yesterday, there are people who have value yesterday that are very talented, and you mix them with people who are today that have value. Agents have learned, all the talent agents in town, whether it's at Gersh or CAAWME, that, you know, Pierce Brosnan wants to make a cool movie where he's a hitman, an aging hitman who has a bladder problem. He's not going to get paid the way he gets paid when he's James Bond. And they've learned that. They've been trained that by Michael, by Jamin, who says, I'm not going to pay him for that. And if you don't want him in the movie, I'll go cast Dustin Hoffman. Who cares?
Right. And do you think the actors and directors these days are receptive to this now?
Yeah. Well, we just put together a movie that John Slattery directed, his first film. And we put Philip Seymour Hoffman, Richard Jenkins, Christina Hendricks, and John Turturro, and they all got paid scale. Because they all wanted to make a movie that was a very cool Elmer Leonard-esque, you know, Mystic River type of film that they don't get cast in very often. So to do it, they all wanted to do it. So I'm actually finding that today is a really good time to make quality independent films at the right price point where there's a value where everybody takes the upside. I'm negotiating a deal with Adam Sandler right now for scale on a movie that he generally wouldn't do.
I mean, Mike, you're in those conversations all the time with agents. Do you feel like
I just showed it to Michael.
Done.
Ha, 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 ha. Yeah, all right, we'll talk about that one afterwards. Anyway,
Cassian's producer.
I want to be on everything, man.
I'd say you make 25 movies in 3 years.
Yeah. Mike, you're talking to agents all day long. What's that? What are those conversations like?
Very, very painful. No, I mean, usually it's, you know, which of your really, really big stars wants to make really, really no money to do this really great movie, and they're like, well, none of them. But, you know, right now, you know, I'm doing a movie where we have 9 pretty good actors who are all making scale. So, you know, I guess it happens. But I mean, I guess, you know, what I always like to say is that the bigger the star is, the more they can afford to do my movie for nothing.
And Kerry, when you're in the middle of all these conversations too, because you're part of this process, are you trying to help the producers negotiate the deals with the actors and the agents? Are you in the middle of that stuff?
Most of the time, yeah. We do have to negotiate deals unless it's a studio film, and then the business affairs at the studio negotiates deals above a certain level, and then we take on the rest of them. We also talk to the producers about, you know, how many points they have to share. And if it's a tiered level of actors, then there's a top tier of the actors that are meaningful, and then a second tier that, you know, is paid to the actors that are known, and then the bottom tier that scale. And then there's point sharing in the producer's points, which, you know, goes to the creative team. And I've seen, you know, my company has seen, you know, money from, you know, producer's points that we've had, which is really nice.
But I think one of your strengths and what you do so well, and what really smart casting directors who have quality movies like you have, what you do so well, better than negotiating financing, is explaining to the talent agents why the client needs to do the movie creatively. Yeah. Because a good casting director, which Kerry is one of the best, is all about, look, don't worry about the money. They need to do it because of this.
Well,
it's really amazing that talent agents would rather hear from him than they would from him.
Right.
I think one of the things that Kerry just touched on that's really clever and something that's been effective for me and for Cass, I know, too, is, you know, when you tell people that, you know, we're going to make this movie for this tiny little budget, but you're not the only one who's taking a pay cut. So, you know, there are other people doing it. And so all of a sudden, you know, we're making this movie for a fraction of what the price could be. And so thus, because you and these other stars are doing it and all doing it for a fraction of your normal price, the reality of getting recouped, the investor recouped, and actually getting to the back end and getting to those points is real, and it's very possible. And so, you know, a way to get people to take a pay cut is to give them a larger percentage ownership of the back end of the movie, and then get more than just one person to take a pay cut.
Well, I mean, what I found too, and Harvey said to me the other day, oh yeah, cockamamie casting. That was like a year ago or 2 years ago, you know, because what I've seen happening quite a bit is a lot of big stars doing independent movies, and a lot of big stars actually doing them with each other because they wanted to work with each other and they found the perfect vehicle to do it. And this is where you get into the more complicated area of like, okay, certainly like on The Butler, we were sitting there and my partner, Pam, was like, how the heck, everybody's working for $65,000. We've got 10 movie stars in this picture. How are we going to give them any kind of back end? And you sit there and you go, okay, hold on a second. Like, so one of these actors is going to be in this movie for 8 weeks. Another one's going to be in it for 3 days. They're all getting paid the same amount of money. But on the back end, I mean, Mike, you've probably faced this too, and certainly you, Jay, and Jamin, you've seen this. How do you manage that? How do you juggle that with all the you know producers want to get some points, the directors want to get some points. You got the way films are being sold now independently. You're seeing multiple actors doing movies. It's not just one star or two stars. There's like five or six, and some are bigger than others. I mean, how do you juggle that?
Well, I think that the best way to do it is to plead poverty. So after you've given away a lot of the points already, you don't have a lot of points left, right? So, you know, you sort of have to lock in your share early and then sort of say, well, and this is spoken for this person and that's spoken for this person. So all we have is, you know, 10 points left, so you can have 5 of them, and that's a lot. Whereas if you still had 50 points left, offering them 5 doesn't seem like a whole bunch. So I think, you know, it's important to lock in your pieces of cast in order of importance. So, you know, when you just don't cast backwards is what I would say. So don't ever cast 2 or 3 supporting roles before you cast your lead, because they're going to eat up all your points and then you're not going to get your lead. So cast your lead first, or, you know, you're likely to pay the consequences.
I mean, Jamin, actually, this is not the right question for Jamin. Here's the right question for Jay. How many times does that pay off for the actors and the director and the producers in terms of the back ends?
Not very often.
That's what I thought you were going to say.
It pays off because creatively they get to do something that matters to them. I mean, for a long time I was partners with Dustin Hoffman, and Dustin Hoffman used to, it drove him crazy that he couldn't just go and work every day. And he was like, if I was a sculptor, I could just sculpt every day. I could paint. And I'd be like, but you can. You just don't, because you want $7 million and 37% of the gross. So you can't do that every day. But if you just go to a play, or you do television, or you do an indie film, you could work every day. They all have to understand and learn the value of what a movie is, right? So George Clooney can go do a huge film, and then he can go do a little film. And
do you find yourself explaining that quite a bit, though, to talent?
Every day. Well, look, the reality is fighting and kicking and screaming, no agent. Every agency makes money off of how much a talent client makes. So the less the talent client makes, the less money the agency makes.
I mean, this is, I think, by the way, something that's very, very good for you guys to understand. As you go out and you try to put the deals together for movies that you're working on and try to cast them, because this panel is called equity financing, but it really, in a way, equity financing goes hand in hand with the movie making process, and the movie making process, the beginning of it is the casting part of it. My advice would be is you go find the J in each agency, and each agency has groups of people that are doing this, and find them, because the agent who has a client that would actually like to do your movie, well, from my experience, was usually very unrealistic about what the deal was going to look like. And so somebody who was experienced in making deals for independent movies would actually have to explain to that agent why they couldn't get what they thought they were going to get. And so I would say that as you go through the process, if you find the star that wants to do it, go find the independent agent. By the way, they want to be found, because they've come up with a whole other way to make money in this business that's different, right, Jay?
Well, and that's exactly it. I mean, Chris and Stewart just did a movie under $1 million, and we structured a deal that gave her certain territories outside the United States that she controlled. So when revenue came in, went straight to her. The equity investors were going to be pretty comfortable, because we had an equity investor who had a star who usually makes $10 million a movie working for scale. So we could create a structure that made sense for both the equity investor.
Michael, would you do a deal like that? Will you give away parts of the collateral to the actor to have them in the movie?
I won't even give parts of the collateral away to the other investors. Are you kidding me?
That's true, by the way.
Speaking of which,
we're just in the middle of one. Yeah.
So you know that answer.
How?
I didn't bring it to Michael.
I might have done it for Kristen Stewart for $700,000, though.
You might know the answer to this one, because I know the other boys do, but I want to keep you in the conversation. You wonder, I'm going to bring you back and Kerry too in a second, and then we're going to go out and ask some questions from the audience. But Jamin, how do you kind of like make sure that all the money is coming in and goes to the people it's supposed to go to when the money does eventually come in? I know Mike has got a whole point of view on this, but your point of view, because you were obviously at Wellview, how do you manage the money, if there is, and the deals that are being made and where the revenue is coming back, to make sure that all the people that actually were the profit participants in the movie are getting what they're supposed to get?
Yeah, there's two major components of assurances that even the equity needs and is helpful to convince the equity. One is having a bond company to insure the film and make sure that film gets completed on time and on budget. And obviously many of you know that already. But that bond company will give that equity investor who's never been in this space before, doesn't know the risk, or doesn't know, like, there's always these, I find new people into the equity space, into the independent films, are always like, oh, well, I hear these things, like, you always go over budget. But that's not true. You don't always go over budget. You stay on budget, and that's because you have a bond company, and you have to make it for the number that you agree upon with that bond company.
What happens when the director says to you, oh, man, I want this extra shot, and I need another day of shooting and whatever? What do you normally say to them?
It depends on a number of factors. I think if you're in week two and you're on budget, you say, bond company, let's give us a rain day. And then they say yes. And I think if you're professional with them and treat them with respect, and you actually know what you're doing and have a line producer that can execute, that has creatively engaged with the director enough that pre-production is smart, you can actually do that. You can get those extra things. I mean, it's like on Hateship, we had this $65,000 song that we had to have. Well, we had saved enough money in the contingency, we could up that song budget by that amount. And that's what really, you know, gives you the... In post-production, you actually have a little bit of money freed up if you've done well and your contingency is still intact. It's a little harder on the upfront side, so I don't even know how to answer that. But the other big, major, important factor is this is a collection account. So there's something that's called a CAMA, a collection account management that is... What's it?
What's it?
It's a collection account management agreement.
Agreement, yeah.
Agreement.
And it basically is a third party that collects all the money in from all the buyers, and then that money gets dispersed in a waterfall according to all the inter-party, you know, contracts.
And these deals are so complicated sometimes in terms
they
of who
are
gets
boring.
What. And the people that do this, there's only two companies that do it, Vintage
and Freeway.
And Freeway. And they're based offshore because certain countries will, they're Dutch-based companies, I think it is.
No, it's Hungary.
Is it?
Yeah, it's a tax shelter.
Oh, well, it's a tax shelter because there are certain countries around the world where they want to deduct a withholding tax from the money that they're paying you for the rights to the film. And the Hungary has...
It's not shady, though. It's really legitimate.
No, it's completely legit. They have tax treaties with each other that allow them to say, don't deduct the tax, the withholding tax. And so that's why we all use them, quite frankly. And that's how we've managed to convince equity investors. And I think, quite frankly, equity investors are very comfortable with that now, Mike, having a collection account. I mean, have you ever been involved where there wasn't one?
Never.
Part of every solicitation that I make, the bond company parameters and the collection account are on there, are part of it.
Have you worked on any films where there weren't collection accounts?
No, and I don't ever recommend an equity investor putting money without one.
Right. I mean, it's...
Don't do it.
Yeah, don't do it. It's
sorry.
Well, I'll contradict that, because I think you should do it in the right case, but I know where you guys are.
What case?
I mean, I'm from a country where there's no collection account, okay?
Me too.
So for...
America, there's no collection accounts here.
No, so for half of a Yellow Sun, because it's a cross-country collaboration, there is a collection account. But there's a collection account for the international receipts. For the Nigerian receipts, you know, Freeway, who we're working with, will not collect in Nigeria because it'll be small amounts in Naira being converted to foreign currency and the like. So we found a local solution for it.
That's an exception rather than the rule, I would say. I think that in general, I can't remember a movie where there wasn't one. And quite frankly, the lawyers for the creative side want these CAM agreements now because they want to make sure that nobody's taking anything that they shouldn't get and that their client who's worked for no money now is kind of in a position where it's all been done really strictly by the contracts and therefore that they're getting a fair shake on these things.
Well,
right,
I think
Jay?
The waterfalls are so complicated between debt, mezz, equity, foreign sales, everybody, that the only way to make sure for an investor that there's truly no conflict of interest, that we don't have to worry about a producer who's taking fees or a distributor who's overcharging, is to put a collection account on there, because they police all the revenue that comes in. So there's no individual that has a conflict of interest.
Yeah, I think the important thing is that the money all goes to someone who doesn't get to keep any of it.
Absolutely.
So then, you know, they're going to give the person who's supposed to get the money, because they know that in no case do they get to make, you know, a petition that, oh, I get to keep, you know, this much extra. So, you know, the collection account takes a tiny little fee, and then they give it to the right person because they have no, you know, they have no preference who gets it, so they give it appropriately.
Mike,
so
do you have a, like a, oh, sorry, Yewande. What were you going
to say? So in our own market where there's no collection account, the structure we've used instead is a trustee. And the trustee
Which
holds
the
money
account.
And understands what the waterfall is and distributes accordingly.
Let us know how that works out.
Mike, if a movie starts to look like it's going to cost more than your original game plan for that film, do you start to make emotional decisions, or do you try to stick with the game plan that you originally set out for yourself?
You know, I think it's hard not to get emotional sometimes about the movie business. You know, you care about each film, and you have relationships with people involved, and you have your hopes and aspirations for what the movie's gonna be, and then you find yourself in a situation where it's all sort of not happening the way you hoped it was going to, and you have to make a decision on whether you're gonna pony up some good money after bad and try to, you know, salvage the film and make it what you always hoped it was gonna be, or if you wanna cut your losses. I've definitely done both. Right now I'm spending extra money on a movie that went over budget, but I think we have, you know, enough big stars in it and enough potential there that we'll be fine even at the increased price. And
would you ever do a movie where you didn't control it?
Yeah, I've done movies where I don't control it, but I'd have to know the person who did. I mean, I would never do a movie where somebody I didn't know was in charge.
Right. Okay, we're going to go to questions in 1 second, but I'm going to ask one last question to all our panelists because it's basically free commercial time. What are you the most excited about, Jamin, in your life right now in terms of movies that you're working on?
Wow, that's a great question. Well, I'm actually most excited about working on a Canadian film. It's a collaboration with an old producer friend of mine named Paul Barkin. He's got a film called a writer-director here from Toronto called Jason Reno, and it's a much different finance scheme than what we're used to.
By the way, scheme's not a good word in America.
Scheme is a good word, and it's a different scenario.
America. Yeah.
And it's a
finance plan.
It's a finance plan. It's a schedule. And it's called Double Exposure, and I'm going into production on a movie right now, which is a U.S.-Chinese co-production called Beijing, New York. Both super exciting from a finance perspective and creatively just super
great.
Solid. One's
Kerry.
A genre film,
I know.
One's
we gotta
a drama.
We're going to get to the questions because I can see the time. Sorry. What are you excited about?
Actually, Beijing, New York.
All right, great. Yewande, what are you excited about?
The public reaction to Half of a Yellow Sun and what we hope to be a resounding commercial success.
Right, well, then you got to buy some tickets.
Yeah, if you can.
And get your friends. All right. Jay, what are you the most excited about right now?
I just think there are so many great opportunities. There's so many new
domestic distributors.
What did he say? There's so many new domestic distributors in the marketplace that it gives us that many more opportunities to sell movies in America, which is really
by the way, that's a very good point, and I want to point that out, that the U.S. market actually is picking up and is far more vibrant, and that's a whole separate conversation because that has to do with VOD and other ancillary rights that are starting to come into play, but with that, we're not going to touch on that. Mike, what are you the most excited about?
That besides the Adam Sandler movie that me and Jay just closed?
that I'm involved in too, right?
Yeah, naturally. I'd say Cymbeline. I'm doing this adaptation of a little-known Shakespeare play that's in production right now in New York. And we have actors working for scale, Ethan Hawke, Ed Harris, Mila Jovovich, John Leguizamo, Penn Badgley, Dakota Johnson, Anton Yelchin,
Dakota's doing that 30 Shades of Grey or whatever.
It's 50, and she is.
Oh.
It's 50 Shades of Grey.
I was trying to bring the budget down.
You have a girlfriend the right age to read that book.
Oh,
you
I know all
know
about that.
That
book, unfortunately. All righty, then.
Tell me no more.
Uh-huh. I'm English, so that book was actually quite good. let's see now. We've talked a lot. I was going to say what I'm excited about, but I'm excited about the Adam Sandler movie too. Okay.
Okay. Thanks for your thoughts. Very simple question. When you go buy a lighter in the store and you open up, there is a note there. Do not light in front of your face. Do not light in front of your face, so you get burned. My question is simple. I'm an experienced director, writer. In a project, I complete everything you said. How do I get in touch
with
to
you?
Put my movie with the right person?
All right, well,
from
Jay,
guys,
I mean, that's a...
You
oh, you want...
Hold
on, you're making your movie in Nigeria?
No.
Oh, all right, okay.
Wait, how do you get in touch with who?
What's the best strategy?
To get in touch with what? Financiers?
Finance people, with you, or people like you that are in the business.
Look us up on IMDb.
Wait, pay
for IMDb Pro. You get our contact info right there.
But you're saying you have a movie that is ready to go. You have your cast, your money. I'm missing what you're saying.
I have the script, the director. You have everything but the cast. Everything, the locations. I know what I'm planning.
Who's the cast?
And where do you live?
Yeah.
Kajol.
Who?
It's a very famous Bollywood actress.
Oh, it's a Bollywood movie?
It's a movie that happens in both Toronto and India, so we collect all the markets. It's like a social drama.
I would find a Indian distributor, somebody like Tanweer, who might know the value of that actor or actress, and see if they'll tell you what the movie's worth and if they want to finance it. Or, you know, I mean, I just hired a guy who's a Bollywood producer in my company, and, you know, I would find another Bollywood producer who understands the value of that marketplace and of that market. And
what about the North American part?
No,
you won't find one with that cast.
The movie's worth almost nothing in this country. What movie can you point to that was kind of a Bollywood-type movie that actually worked here? Now, I know that there are exceptions to rules. I know that there are Bollywood pitches that have done big business in America, but they did it primarily for their audience. It didn't do it. It didn't cross over into an American.
And generally with your Western director.
All right, let's get another question. Sorry. Yewande, what were you going to say?
I was going to say my own advice. If you're trying to make a Bollywood movie that'll sell in the West, you have to...
Right, it's got a Bollywood element to it. Yeah. All right, but I'm telling you, but you mentioned that all the American financiers will be heading for that exit.
Look, because of your cast, you need to find someone who understands the value of that cast, which if your cast is a Bollywood star, that's where the value is going to be, so find someone who understands that, which is nobody up here.
Yep.
So just to follow up on the gentleman's question, though, you said IMDb Pro. How would I present something to you? I have a project, well-known graphic novel. I have an LOI from Samuel L. Jackson. I live in a tax credit state. We have all of our locations. How do I get that to someone like you?
See, but that's easy, because all you do is, Sam still at ICM? I don't remember where
he is. Yes.
So Jessica Lacey and Peter Trin, who do exactly what I do at ICM, you call them up or you call Sam Jackson's agent up and say, hook me up with your finance department, and then you're already in because he's the client.
Yeah, 100%. If Sam's doing the movie, Tony Howard should be helping you.
Yeah, we talked to Gersh. Gersh did a coverage on our script.
Right, so but if Tony Howard's client's in the movie, she should call her colleague Peter Trin, who's a pal of mine, a nice guy. You should meet him, and you should do the movie together. Peter Trin will package your movie if Sam Jackson's really in it.
That's funny, because Peter Trin's repping our film that's playing Tuesday night as well.
Talk to Peter. He's a good guy.
Maybe I just missed some dots connecting somewhere.
All right, say to Peter Trin, I would like to meet Michael Benaroya. How about that? I'd like to meet, whoever, whatever.
Well, don't say that, but.
All right. Yeah, by the way, if
you ask
Peter
Trin, you have a star who's repped at a major agency. Yep. That agency's job, as Cassian said at the very beginning, was all the major agencies have full departments like mine who put movies together. So if your star's at one of the agencies, their job is to help you put the movie together. You shouldn't need to call me, although it doesn't mean I wouldn't help you on it, because I rep movies with CA and ICM and WME every day. But the star is rep there by the head of talent at ICM. So they should be helping you. Okay. It's not that hard.
Any more questions?
What about a broad question, not a specific project question?
Right.
Anybody have any period westerns?
Keep open.
They're very easy to put together.
My question actually...
Is there such a thing as a non-period Western?
Yes, they're modern-day Western.
All right. Okay, just checking.
Okay.
Open room.
Yeah, okay. I'm trying to figure out if you get... What's in it for the agent? You know, you're talking about...
Oh, good question. No, 10%. Stop right there. That's a good question.
10%.
No, what I'm saying is that if you are looking to get... You've got a great film, whatever, you think that it would be perfect for X actor, but... The money is going to be a lot lower, but it's an interesting film. They get to play Hitman or whatever the hell it is, you know. What is in it for the agent for them to take such a low cut? I was just wondering if the actor's taking some
we got the question,
something?
And it's a great question.
So you're asking how it helps the talent agent for that client, correct?
Yep.
Here's how it helps. It helps because most actors get pigeonholed into types of movies that they get to make, right? So Sandra Bullock is doing comedies. She doesn't want to do comedies. Kristen Stewart is doing vampire movies. She doesn't want to do vampire movies. What agents look for are movies and parts that will showcase them to other producers and studio executives who will say, I didn't know she could do that.
Basically, you want the talent agent to be thinking long-term with their client. So this movie, if it helps their client's career, they'll get paid on the next one.
I would say call the manager, not the agent.
No.
What a dick.
All right. All right, this
like we represent Brie Larson. Larson does all these great movies, but Brie Larson isn't a box office star, yet she's an amazing actress. So what her agent does on a daily basis looks for genres that will help her have more value in other markets than what she is today.
Right. Good one.
Hello. What would be your advice to a young director like me? I've done about a dozen award-winning shorts. And I always been told you have to do your first feature. And I have one right now with Riley Keough attached to it and Mia Kitchener. How can I reach out to somebody like you
Do you have an agent?
No.
Do you have a producer?
Yes.
Does the producer have any relationships with any of the agents?
You know,
not necessarily.
You know what you should do? You should talk to the people who made Riley's last movie, Indomitable Entertainment.
That's a good point. But I would say if you're literally working with a producer who has no relationships in Hollywood with the agencies or the management companies or the lawyers or whatever, you've got a problem. And you need to find an executive producer who does, who can walk your project around. Because you trying to do it on your own, believe me, it's not going to work. It won't work.
I want to ask one question. You said you directed shorts before, right?
Yes.
I've never met an agent who wouldn't watch a short, unless it's an hour and a half. Sure. So it's not really a short. But if it's a 10-minute short,
yes.
I've never met an agent that wasn't willing to spend 10 minutes. By the way, every agent at every agency has an assistant. The assistant's job is to find and discover talent. So you should be figuring out what feature-lit agent, you know, 10
it's
minutes.
It's not that easy. I've tried.
No, I know. But I mean, look, the thing is that you
get in with the assistant.
You find an executive producer. Find somebody who is in Hollywood and say, look, if I make my movie, I'll pay you $75,000, and let them go out and do this work for you. You don't have to do it. You're going to knock your head against the wall.
Or submit your shorts to festivals, and people go watch shorts at festivals looking for talent.
They're all over the place right now.
All right, well, that's a good thing.
Okay, well, then probably people have seen
somebody who's, like, organizing things for you.
I think Cassian's right. Find another producer or two, and if your producer has fears about bringing other people in, they probably
have. How many more questions do we got, Renee? Okay, this is the last question, so it better be a good one.
Well, there's a little bit of pressure now, but on the Beijing New York film, what percentage of the financing came from China?
What?
I don't want to be too specific.
You know what? Honestly, that one's the most complicated financing arrangement. I wouldn't. That's partially Chinese, and there's Chinese
just
money in it.
Just give a broad answer. Less than half, more than half.
It's probably half equity, half structured finance.
Right. We got time for one more question because that was a short answer.
I'm Jude. I'm
Well done, Jude.
Yeah, I'm proudly Nigerian, and this question is for my sister Yewande.
Yes.
Who you guys have ignored?
Come on. Well, hold on. What did you just say?
Yeah,
ignored.
Yeah, Yewande, we're really, really, really impressed. Speaking for ourselves, Nigerians, what you've done with half of the Yellow Sun.
Yes.
My question will be, how were you able to attract international talent in terms of Chiwetel and Thandie Newton to take a culturally...
That's an excellent question.
I haven't finished my question, please. take such talent and attach them to a culturally...
Are you an actor?
...unique material.
He has to
material.
Be, right? You're an actor.
No, I'm not.
Oh, you're not? Oh,
I'm all right.
You should be.
Yep.
I think the reason, both Thandie and Chiwetel were interested is the same reason people have mentioned on this panel why... big actors would do a small movie. It probably gives them an opportunity to display another part of their creative spectrum. So for them, it's different from, everything else that they've done and allows them to show show another piece of the breadth of their experience. And from a financial perspective, obviously the numbers were not as big as they would be for many of the films they do. And I remember for one person's agent in particular, they came back to say, there was a mistake in the communication we had sent. There were two zeros missing. Of course, there were. We didn't have two zeros missing. That was what we could offer. So they both participate exactly for the same reasons. One is breadth of experience, but the other one is also a potential to participate in the upside. And we're very hopeful that there will be upside.
Right.
So
I want to finish before we get thrown off the stage here. I just want to say one last thing, okay? Do not be discouraged by anything that we're saying. We're just trying to give you guys information here, okay? Do not be discouraged as a producer. Never give up. If you really, really, really want to do this as a director, as an actor, as a producer, as a financier, and you're frustrated and it's not happening the way that you want it to happen, do not give up. Find another way around. Just if you believe in the movie that you're trying to make, you've got to go get it made, because if you don't, you're going to live in your whole life with some kind of regret, and you don't want that. Go out, be passionate, and make stuff happen.
All right. Before we get off all... Yeah, sorry, guys. I know everyone is very eager to ask some follow-up questions. We do have to take a quick photo, so if you can just hold your seats for a second. And we also have a couple of our panelists who do need to go to another meeting, so they might not be able to stay. Thank you.